Hello and welcome to A Healthy Mind. I'm Dr. Sislena Grocer-Ledbetter, Director of Counseling and Student Development at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. In his 2013 Washington Post article, Chris Richards writes, "When the on-air light is glowing, his voice blurs warm and cool. When it goes down, he shouts along to the music, taps his oxfords on the grimy carpet, grabs at the air as if wrangling some phantom trumpet. The radio station's mantra is jazz and justice. But for 3 hours every Monday night, justice gives way to the undiluted wisdom of Robert Norton, the 78-year-old jazz traveler known to listeners as Brother Ah. Joining me to talk about the healing power in music is Robert Norton, known as Brother Ah, musician, composer, educator, and WPFW radio host. He has played and recorded with musical greats, including Thelonius Monk, John Coltrane, Miles Davis, McCoy Tyner, Freddie Hubbard, Sun Ra, Dizzy Gillespie, Eric Dolphy, Max Roach, John Lewis, and many more. Thank you, Brother Ah, for joining me on today.
And I'm excited just to be in your presence.
Yeah, so the community, those of us who love you and support you and are just in awe about what you do, call you Brother Ah. Where did Brother Ah come from?
Well, you know, that was a given name. It was really my students at Dartmouth. I taught at Dartmouth College from 1970 to 1973. And either I started all of my lectures with Ah, or my music emanated Ah, because the students started to call me Brother Ah.
Seriously?
That's all, Brother Ah. So I began to wonder about that name, and it was a large class. I had 50 students, and several of the students were from different countries. So the first, the Egyptian student came to me and said, you know, Ah means the god of the moon in ancient Egypt, as Ra means the god of the sun. And the Sufi students came to me and said, you know, we chant Ah as we swirl and whirl in this desert, you know, the whirling dervishes. And so everybody in the class who was from another country told me what that meant in their culture. So it stuck, Ah, Brother Ah. Everybody called me Brother Ah. So the name stuck as a nickname. And eventually I went to a numerologist and I said, listen, I need to know about this name in terms of how it fits with Robert Northern, my
wow.
family name.
Yes.
And they did the numbers. And they said, well, you just have to drop one H, before with A-H-H. So they dropped one H, and they said, that's really consistent with your family name,
wow.
so you can use it.
And you know what? Maybe, here's my interpretation. Your voice sort of glides. You have a melodic kind of voice. You probably heard that a lot. But your voice is very sultry and soothing. So that's the Ah. That's what I made up before I actually found out.
Okay.
The
well, they must have heard that because it became
yeah.
Ah.
Yeah.
Whenever I appeared, it was Ah.
Yeah, and you have such an incredible past. And so the question, where did you start with this music is, I think it starts all the way back to Watermelon. How did it go? I want to hear that.
Well, I'm born in Kinston, North Carolina,
yes.
and I'm raised in the South Bronx.
Yes.
I went from North Carolina to Harlem to the South Bronx, and
yes.
back in the
yes.
day, back...
Traditional migration patterns, you know. North
yes.
Carolina, New York, everybody in the Bronx is from North Carolina.
There you go.
You know,
there you go.
That's right.
But I became quite familiar with the hawkers back in the day, and I'm talking about in the late 30s, early 40s, where everything was with horse and wagon still. Yeah, they came through the community with horses, and in their wagons they had all of the beautiful fruits and vegetables, and they would chant, watermelon, sweet berries, all of these beautiful sounds. And I, at that time, had a bugle, so I would imitate all of the different calls that they would make. So I became acutely aware, and then I used to sit on my fifth floor fire escape. Now, a fire escape is the iron steps outside of the tenement houses in New York.
Yes.
So you can escape from a fire. But it became my balcony.
Right, right, right.
It became my balcony.
Yes.
And on this fire escape were all of these birds.
Mm-hmm.
And I would imitate the sounds of the birds. Mm-hmm. I was very conscious of the wind or of the dogs barking downstairs. So I began to become involved in the entire community through sound.
So is there ever, you hear music in everything, or is there ever silence?
No, I'm hearing music right now. I'm hearing,
wow.
Yeah, I'm constantly hearing sound.
Yes.
Constantly.
And does that create music for you?
Yes, it always does. I mean, I can remember when I used to be in the subway and the rhythm of the subway going through Manhattan were drum rhythms as far as I'm concerned. And I used to come and play the same rhythms that I heard that the train made on the track.
What? In the subway of New York?
The subway of New
York.
Now
that's some real talent. Yeah. You translated that?
Translated the window wipers on the buses in New York. They had some wonderful rhythms.
Yeah.
So all of that, I got very sensitive to sound very young, starting at 5 years old.
Yeah, really. So you walk outside sometimes and stop.
Yeah, and listening. Yeah, I'm listening to everything. It's until today, I'm hearing everything.
So you walk outside sometimes and stop.
Yeah, and listening. Yeah, I'm listening to everything. It's until today, I'm hearing everything.
You're hearing everything. That's amazing. And you have, your playground was all of these greats. So you played with everybody, Max Roach and you name it. So who are the people that really influenced you, that you enjoyed?
My biggest influence was Sun Ra. I performed with Sun Ra for 9 consecutive years. Mm-hmm. And he taught me a lot about nature. As a matter of fact, when I joined his band back in the 1960s, I had been studying at the Academy of Music in Vienna, Austria. I had been studying at the Manhattan School of Music, you know, European classical music. I had been performing at the Metropolitan Opera House, and I had been visiting. And so I got into Sun Ra's band as a very learned musician. I started out as a natural musician imitating nature as a child.
And what were you playing?
French horn.
French horn.
That's my,
that's right.
My main instrument.
That's
my,
right.
And I started out as a child imitating nature. And when I went to formal schools, I got indoctrinated into a whole other way of thinking, which was academic.
Wait, so you started playing French horn by ear?
No, I started, not the French horn, the trumpet.
The trumpet.
I'm originally a trumpet player.
Okay, see.
And, I started out as a bugler.
Right, right. That's what I was going to say.
I went from the bugle to the trumpet by ear. Well, let's not by ear. Let's say the oral tradition.
Okay.
I'm from the oral tradition.
Oral tradition.
Yeah, there are two traditions side by side in the world, and that's the notated tradition of the Western world, and there's the oral tradition, which is the African tradition, which is the tradition of jazz musicians. We didn't depend upon reading. We didn't stop at the secondary process of reading. We went directly to the sound. So I started out as a jazz trumpet player, a jazz bugler, a natural bugler to a jazz trumpet player as a teenager. And then when I went to High School of Performing Arts in Manhattan, I got interested in the French horn and I began to study music.
So tell me what Brother Ah is doing now.
What I'm doing now and enjoying is that I'm teaching children pre-K through the fifth grade in the DC public school system, and also in some private schools, mm-hmm. Jamal Montessori School.
Yes.
And I'm teaching children, I've dedicated myself to teaching children because there's where the healing needs to start.
And what are you teaching them?
Mainly percussion and drums, because that's very, 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 very important in the whole art of healing. Percussion and drums, mm-hmm. in terms of the brain, you know, it changes better. The alpha waves in the brain changes the beta waves in the brain, and it has a calming effect. Mm-hmm. It relieves stress and pain. It stimulates growth. I mean, all kinds of things happen by drum circles. Right. So I have drum circles starting at pre-K through fifth grade,
that's. Really cool.
Yeah, that's what I, and I love doing it, that's what I'm doing.
So I want you to talk about what the healing, so the community calls you a healer, okay? So let me just put that out there. We call you a healer, but I know you don't call yourself a healer.
Yes.
But tell me about the healing work that has happened as a result of your work in the hospitals.
Yeah, well, I spent several years at the Lombardi Cancer Center at George Washington University, mm-hmm. and I work with cancer patients with brain cancer, bone cancer, breast cancer, mostly adults, but some children. And I also worked there at performing and working with the visitors who came in oftentimes depressed, and also with the doctors and the nurses who asked me sometimes to relieve them of stress. And I would work with drums, I would play certain rhythms, stimulating certain parts of the brain, also creating rhythms that really increased cancer cell killers that can actually kill cancer cells, and also helps other diseases as well. So I began working one-on-one. I would go into the wards and work with people before, during, and after chemotherapy, and work with them on drums and with wind instruments. And I perform with them while they're going through their therapy. And amazing things have happened. Amazing things. I know, remember one time I was performing in the lobby of the cancer center for the visitors, and a lady, a Chinese lady, came down, and she was had her pole with all of her IVs in her arm, and she walked down and she came to me and she said, "You know, I have been lying in my bed upstairs for weeks from nausea. Your music floated up to me, my nausea stopped." And she began to cry. She says, "I've been nauseous for 3 or 4 weeks. I heard your music and it stopped. And I came down and I didn't know. The doctor said you have to get exercise. I didn't know how to exercise." She started dancing all over the lobby with her IV pole. So all kinds of wonderful things have happened just by knowing, consciously directing my music for certain parts of the body.
So how do you know? Have you figured this out?
Well, I learned a lot in Africa.
Yes.
You know, my first really experience of seeing music therapy work was in the bush in Africa by the healers. Really, my first experience of myself being transformed is when my first trip to Africa was in 1972. Mm-hmm. I stepped off of the plane, did not expect to. I fell on my face and I cried. Mm-hmm. I cried so hard, I almost lost consciousness. And I was surrounded by drummers. The baggage handlers were drummers as well. They all grabbed their drums and they surrounded me. And they played these rhythms which brought me to my feet. And that was my first really experience of having myself been affected by drums like that. So that's where it all started. And I began to study in the bush, and I went back to Africa 7 consecutive summers I spent in Africa. I would alternate one summer in West Africa, next summer in East Africa, studying with the drummers and being exposed to the whole understanding of music as a therapeutic method of healing people through sound, through drums. And the other thing that came to me there were the healing effects of nature.
Oh, wow.
And Sun Ra really pushed me when I came, you know, later on, to really understand that for mental stress, for mental health, one should be in nature.
Yes.
Listening to nature. That's why I brought some of these.
Yes, and I want to play in some of this. I'm fascinated because I think that these are all Eastern
instruments.
Well, I've collected them. I've collected them from all over the world.
Yes.
Okay. Actually, I was in Berlin.
Yes.
Performing in Berlin with my band, and an old lady came to me. She looked at my table. I had a 6-foot table with all my instruments. She said, "You have instruments from all over the world, but you don't have anything from my place," which is Prussia. So the next night, she came back to our performance, and she bought me this instrument, which is a porcelain ocarina from Prussia, and I've added it to my collection. So they're from everywhere. This instrument, I use to produce the sound of the wind.
Okay, can we hear it?
The wind is very healing.
It is healing.
Soothing and healing. So when one has mental stress, it is very important that one goes into the park, sit in D.C., sit at one of these places I go to in Rockley Park, where you can actually hear the creek.
It's beautiful.
That's healing. That's healing. When one has, as I said, stress, that's what one does. Listen to the birds. I listen to lots of birds. All of this is like listening to a symphony orchestra in the bush.
Beautiful. It really is beautiful. So how do you know which ones go with which? So say this I don't know, this cancer patient comes down. Do you know which instruments to play for which ailment?
Yes, I've learned over the years, and all through, not only through study, but through experimenting. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this for many years, so I have experimented in many situations to see what works for brain cancer, what works for this kind of cancer, because I've seen the results.
Wow.
I worked at a robotic institute with a woman who had a bone cancer, which is very painful, by the way. And I would go to her room, and I would play certain instruments for her. And one day I was playing in the lobby for the visitors, and she walked in the lobby on a cane. She said, "Brother, look, I'm walking. I have no more pain." I worked with her almost a year. You know. Wow. So these things also by practical practice, I mean practicing it.
Yes, yes.
But the main thing is one has to heal oneself.
Yes.
I realized all a lot of this because I was also very, very ill myself. And I went to my trip, you know, to the forest, and I healed myself. That was the biggest experiment, seeing what worked for me.
Do you have to have faith?
All about prayer. Yes. When I'm working with people who are in pain, it's constant prayer. I'm praying. Nature is praying. Mm. The wind is praying. Mm. Everything that has breath is praying. Yeah. And praising and praying. I learned that in the forest. I learned it so well that once the curator of the of mammals at the zoo called me here in Washington and said, "Brother, we're having a problem at the zoo. And the monkeys are going crazy. They're so nervous." So when the zoo closed down, he asked me to come, and I sat before the monkey cage and chilled them out. He thanked me so much because they were going crazy.
Wow.
He's called me to work with the cheetah. I've worked with cheetahs at the zoo. He called me to work with the blue cranes. You know, the Stanley blue cranes, an endangered bird, would not lay an egg. And so he called me and said, "Help me, Brother Art. We've got to have these birds lay an egg." I came in. I did one show with them.
No.
So what happens is that the male has to trumpet and do sound. The female has to do a crane dance, which is an African dance, by the way. So I studied them for the first show. The second show, I imitated the male. So the sound, the next day, Dr. Gould called me and said, "Man, you're famous. You're in the Washington Post. The bird laid an egg."
What?
The bird laid an egg,
oh,
you know.
My goodness.
So I've been working with animals because not only is the healing process important for humans, it's important for animals and plants.
Yes.
So I work with animals as well and plants as well as humans.
That's incredible. So I want to hear some more. Tell me about play some of your other instruments and tell us what you use them for.
Yes. Well, you see, the memory is very, very important to be able to reach through a person, through sound, to a person's memory and bring back a situation which was at that time they were very happy and peaceful. So this particular instrument, while I was performing in Rockville, Maryland, I played this instrument. I looked around the audience, identified people by their culture, and I saw a lady from India. So I played this. After the performance, she came to me and she hugged me and thanked me. She said, "I haven't heard that sound since I live in a very small village in the hills in India. This is a sound that I heard in India, and I haven't heard it in many years. Thank you for bringing me back home." So when I work with people, and even in the cancer center, I find out what their culture is, and I'll spontaneously create music, you know, based upon their culture. I know enough about different modes and different melodies from around the world that if a person is Jewish, I will improvise Jewish music, which helps them. I will improvise music from whatever culture they happen to be in. You have to know all of these melodies, all of these harmonies, all of these modalities from around the world, which I've studied for years.
Well, yeah.
So this is a tone that's heard in India, but in the villages in the mountains.
Uh-huh.
You have to put a rhythm to it.
Yeah.
Rhythm is the healing aspect.
Yeah, I love that.
And
love
this
that.
Is another one I choose.
What does that do?
You know, this is an instrument that I got because when I was in Africa, I lived in the middle of the forest, and I heard these birds having a conversation, and I wanted to see whether I can get involved in their language and their conversation.
Wow.
So I got involved with playing this instrument with them, and they stopped and listened to me. Then we had a three-way conversation. This goes also to relieve stress. This kicks in a part of the brain that creates there's a chemical like morphine, endorphin.
Serotonin. Like serotonin.
That kicks in when you do certain rhythms, not only certain instrument. Drums do it, but it's the rhythm more than the instrument. Now, people don't realize that. Drumming circles are absolutely necessary in the world. I do it every day. But it's not only the instrument itself, it's the rhythm. Mm. So I can create this rhythms on this with the sound of birds that can kick in so that people who are suffering from pain, particularly, will relate because what will kick in is this built-in morphine.
Mm. Wow, I'm feeling it. I love it. I love it. What do we have next? Yeah.
This is an instrument. Gets into the spirit.
It's
all about prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Healers who are really healers first have to heal themselves.
Yes.
You can't call yourself, you can't be called to heal somebody if you haven't healed yourself.
Yes.
And it's through prayer and meditation, incantation, mm-hmm. and playing music for oneself
that
once you can heal yourself, you can also begin to heal others.
Yes. And I hear Asia,
yeah.
I hear Africa, yeah. India, yeah. And you have found, and I think that you call this sound awareness, because you're always aware of not only sounds that are around you, but you're real cognizant of the people around you.
Absolutely.
Really powerful.
Absolutely.
You got a couple more things I want to hear.
Yeah. Well, okay. You know, this, as I said, I'm gonna stretch a little bit because this is very, very, very healing. This is gong.
Okay.
This is a gong.
Okay.
This is a West African rhythm that was brought to America with the Africans in the Middle Passage. It's also called the Charleston.
Is it?
Don't do deeper.
Great. Ooh, this is like this is a concert for me. I'm getting my own personal concert. Okay, so there's a couple more I want to hear.
Okay.
Is this an instrument?
Conch shell, yes.
Yeah.
That's an instrument.
Because that was on the floor holding my grandma's door open.
Yes. Well, it's an instrument. One can make an instrument from it. It's a conch shell.
Okay.
It's a traditional horn from many parts of the world, yes. Africa and Asia and the Caribbean. And I use this a lot. And it's brothers went down and went down hundreds of feet in the Caribbean and brought this up for me.
Wow.
And you have to make it yourself. You have the most difficult thing about making it is getting the animal out. You know, the conch shell goes and locks himself in.
Yes.
So I found a way to get the animal out, and then you have one chance to cut the end off. You can destroy it. You can't cut it more than once.
I got it
the first time, and it's a trumpet. It's a trumpet. It's a conch shell trumpet, which is played in many parts of the world for healing and for signaling.
Get my groove on and get healed at the same time. That's great. That little thing making all that noise, I love that.
That's just a simple shell.
So we have 1 minute left. I want you to either share a thought about the healing art that you do, or you can choose to take us out with a piece of music. It's going to be your call.
Well, the healing art, as I said, is really ancient.
Yeah.
I mean, when one studies it formally, one has to go back to ancient Egypt, where the musicians were priests and healers. That's the tradition which I've been following. And I'll say it again, it's about prayer. To really be effective, you have to learn how to enunciate certain prayers, certain scriptures even, into the music, which embeds and instills faith into the listener. And then you have to be able to get the listener involved. It's great to play for people for healing, but it's better when they themselves become involved in performing. So drum circles are very, very, very important.
Wow. So thank you so much. And we're going to have the sound of music and the drum circles in our mind. I'd like to thank you for coming to hang out with me and give me my own private concert. I'll be able to say to Brother Ah gave me my own personal concert. If you would like to learn more about Brother Ah and his music, visit his website at www.ahnorthern.com. Thank you for joining me, and I invite you to follow me on Facebook and Twitter at Dr. Sis, or log on to my website, www.drsislena.com. Thank you for watching. See you next time on A Healthy Mind.